Now, your new book is called The Atlas of AI, and when I think of an atlas, I think of maps of our planet. And when I think of AI, I think of maths I can't see. So why do we need an atlas for artificial intelligence, and how does that even work?
Oh, look, you're exactly right. I mean, when we think about AI, do we think about math and code and numbers? But one of the things that has always really motivated my work has been thinking about the social, political, and even the ecological implications of large-scale computation. And it was funny, when I started doing this sort of research sort of over 15 years ago now, it struck me as really strange that artificial intelligence was really only understood in this very narrow way as a technical discipline. And if you looked at all of the AI institutes around the world, they were technical institutes. They would teach you how to code and design algorithms. But none of them were studying or even looking at what the implications might be if you use these systems in healthcare or in education or criminal justice or hiring. So it became really clear to me early on that we had to start looking at artificial intelligence in a much bigger scope. And the reason why I like the sort of the metaphor of the atlas is that atlases help us look at things at different scales. We can look at the scale of a planet, or we can zoom in to sort of a city or a mountain range. And for me, that's the right metaphor for how we think about the way that AI works. Because in every sense, it's using vast amounts of energy, minerals, but also human labor, and also data, primarily scraped off the internet. So I started to think about AI as this emerging extractive industry of the 21st century, almost in the same way that mining was the sort of emerging extractive industry of the 18th century. So that sort of required this idea of putting AI in a bigger landscape, and hence the idea of creating an atlas of AI.
One of the things that we do know about AI is that there is a big gender bias within it, and we've seen this manifest in hundreds, if not thousands, of different ways. You know, women not being shown high-paying ads, you know, facial recognition technology not detecting the faces of women of colour, or detecting them inaccurately, and, you know, resulting in law enforcement situations which are entirely avoidable.
Yes.
We know that this happens, and we've known for years that this has been happening. So why is it still happening?
Well, this is a really important question, and particularly here at All About Women. And it was funny, actually, that Ray and I were sort of joking before the session about, if you do a Google search on AI and you just click images to see all the images that you get for AI, this is what you get. You get robots, you get, like, you know, probably a circuit board. They all kind of look vaguely mannish, very white. So obviously the future is white robots. It's a whole new form of white supremacy. You have men in suits in front of control panels. You know, I mean, this is what it looks like. But in actual fact, what we get is much more like this, which is, you know, sort of not this sort of blue code neutral objective environment, but actually profoundly skewed systems that have been found to do things like, obviously, facial recognition systems that can't detect women of color. We have Apple's credit card that was found to be giving men 80 times the credit of women for all applicants, regardless of their financial status. And of course, Amazon's own AI system for scanning resumes, which they were trialing for a couple of years. And this system was used so that they didn't have to look at all of the resumes that people sent in. And it was found, after testing this system for years, mind you, that all women were being downvoted by the system. If you even had the word woman on your CV, like coach of the women's soccer team, you would be put on the bottom of the pile. And you ask the question of why is this? Well, for me, the Amazon case is so powerful because you can sort of, it makes complete sense. They trained the AI system on the data of their previous successful applicants, their existing workforce. Guess what the gender representation is of the existing workforce of Amazon? Yeah, well, you're right. In the engineering side, it's over 85% male. And that's, I think, a generous Amazon estimate. So you can see, if you train an AI system on the data of the past, you can actually build it into the systems of the future. You inculcate and embed those inequities to be perpetuated in an ongoing sense in time. And we have seen this time and time again in multiple cases. Now, I don't want to oversimplify. There are many ways in which bias creeps into systems. But certainly what we've learned is that it's sort of really primarily around these two big areas. And the first one is technical, and I'll just speak to that briefly. This is a sort of a visualization of ImageNet, which is sort of, you know, one of the most well-known sort of databases that AI has sort of trained on and compared against. And this is really sort of on the technical side. To understand why we keep having these sexist and racist systems is you have to sort of look under the hood at the infrastructures of seeing. You know, how is the world being seen and interpreted by technical systems? Well, we do it by training them on thousands, sometimes millions of pieces of data. It could be images, if it's an image system, or it could be text, if it's a language system. Where does that come from? It's scraped off the internet. So if you're scraping text off Reddit, where you've got, you know, 15-year-old boys talking about, you know, hilarious jokes about girls, that then becomes the textual basis of your system. If you're scraping it off, you know, Yahoo News, which a lot of the sort of the early image databases came from, you'll get a sort of very celebrity-skewed kind of vision of what the world looks like. Again, very sort of white, dominant, male-dominant visions of the world. So at the technical level, we have to look at infrastructures and say that's part of the problem. But there's another problem too, which we don't talk about as much, which is the social side, which is who is in the rooms where we actually design AI systems. You know, who are the engineers who get to decide this is a problem that we can resolve with AI, and these are the people for whom this will work best. We also have to look at who runs these companies. I mean, if you've looked at the CEOs recently or the founders of, you know, the biggest tech companies in the world, you know their names. It's Jeff Bezos, it's Mark Zuckerberg, it's, you know, it's all of the kind of the names that we know well from almost entirely white men.
Yeah.
And I think that has skewed the kinds of thinking and the kinds of priorities that these technical systems are serving. And obviously, they're created to make a lot of money. And so, you know, they're not here as civic infrastructures, but I think we commonly think they are. There's a mistake that we assume that, oh, Facebook is really here just so that we can communicate with our friends and share news. Isn't that fantastic?
So great.
Until, of course, we get last week when, of course, they start having a fight with the Morrison government and decide to just switch off the tap. And then you realize, no, this is a private infrastructure, purely yeah. for profit. And as much as they have tried to, they've really spent a lot of money for us to believe that this is really there for our soccer clubs and our friends and our, you know, student groups. But it's not. And this is the very big trap, I think, when we start to look at the way that we've come to rely on these as civic infrastructures.